Well, all right, guys, I'm so glad you're here today. And let me ask you, have you ever experienced trials in your life? Well, of course you have, right? We all have. Well, today in our look at Mark, we're going to see the disciples in the midst of the storm, and we're going to learn some valuable lessons that we can apply to our life when the waves come rolling in. Now, let's read our passage, Mark 4, 35 through 41. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat just as he was, and other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling, but he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even wind and sea obey him?" Good question, isn't it? Well, here's the background. Jesus and his disciples have had a full day of exhausting ministry. It's hot, the crowds have been huge, and the day has been filled with activity, noise, and chaos. Finally, evening arrives, and Jesus, being exhausted from the day's labor, decides to take his disciples across the lake to a place that is quieter so they can rest. But here on the Sea of Galilee, an ordinary boat ride turns into an extraordinary event, as Jesus takes his disciples into the classroom with lessons prepared for their growth. Now let's pick up the narrative in verse 35 with the Lord's command. Verse 35 through 36 says, "On that day when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat just as he was, and other boats were with him." So, nothing out of the ordinary here, right? A group of tired ministers getting into a boat and leaving for a much-needed time of rest. Then Jesus moves to the stern of the boat, where he falls into a deep sleep. So far, so good. A serene scene on the lake, but that will be shattered soon by a violent storm. And in this storm, we're going to learn some valuable lessons. So here's our outline. We're going to break this passage up into four sections. First, lessons from the severe storm. Then, lessons from the sleeping Savior. Third is lessons from the sudden stillness. Then we'll end with lessons from the Savior's scrutiny. So lessons from the severe storm, verse 37. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling. Now, because of the geography of the area, violent storms were common on this lake. It's located 638 feet below sea level, and it's surrounded by mountains with deep ravines. And those ravines acted like gigantic funnels that focused the wind down onto the lake. So these severe storms could suddenly happen with no warning, and that was normal. But this one must have been unusually violent, because these fishermen who were so used to storms on this lake, they're terrified by this one. Scripture tells us the waves were buffeting the boat and crashing over the side. We're told the boat was already filling. In other words, it was starting to flood. So this is serious stuff. Now, over in Matthew's account, he uses a very descriptive word for what was happening here. He uses the word we use for earthquakes, seismos. In other words, it was as if this lake was being shaken violently by this storm. So the boat is being tossed about, the waves are crashing over the side, filling it with water, and these hardened fishermen are terrified. They feel helpless against this onslaught of nature. Now that's the background. So let's move now to the lessons we learned from the storm. Now I've got two. We learned that Christ's disciples aren't exempt from difficulty. I mean, we can think trials are unusual for the believer. I mean, unless we've really messed up with some major sin. And it's true, sin will bring trials into our life. We see this with Jonah. The storm was sent to turn him from his rebellion. So if you're living in sin, you can expect storms. This is the Father's loving discipline to turn you back to him. But these disciples, they weren't in sin. They were right in the middle of God's will, weren't they? They were out on that lake because they had obeyed Christ's command. So why did Jesus send these disciples out into a storm he knew was coming? Here it is, because the lake was the classroom and the storm was that day's curriculum. They were going to learn things in that storm that only that storm could teach them. Now that brings us to the second lesson we learned from the storm. It's this: trials and difficulties are necessary for the believer to grow. See, without difficulty, we remain shallow, immature, and ineffective. So it takes trials to fashion a depth into us. And this is why the Bible views trials in a positive light, because they're able to replace that immaturity with a spiritual death. J.C. Ryle said this: "By affliction, God shows us our emptiness and weakness, draws us to the throne of grace, purifies our affections, weans us from the world, and makes us long for heaven. On the resurrection morning, we will all say, 'It was good for me to be afflicted.' We will thank God for every storm." So in heaven, with full clarity on how beneficial our trials were, we will thank God for every one of them. But let me suggest that we start thinking more clearly now, thinking more biblically about our trials, so we can thank Him now. So how do trials benefit us? Now I've got a few thoughts here, and we'll go through the first few very quickly, and then we'll spend some time as we move along. First thing is, they help purify us. Psalm 119:67, "Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word." So after the trials, after the affliction, he now keeps God's word. They also drive us back to God when we have strayed. Look at Hosea 5:15. "I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face, and in their distress," there it is, "and in their distress earnestly seek me." So distress can cause us to seek him. Next, in our trials, when they cause us to turn to God, when they cause us to seek him, we experience him in a greater way. See, the trial provides a wonderful opportunity to experience God's comfort, doesn't it? 2 Corinthians 1:4 tells us, "He comes to us to comfort us in our afflictions." Romans 5:3-5 tells us we will experience God's love in a greater way when we're suffering. See, we know his comfort and his love in trials differently than in times of ease. It's much deeper. But now here's where I want to spend some time. Our trials cause spiritual growth. James 1:2-4 says this: "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." Now, I remember telling somebody that God tells us to have joy in times of trial. You know what? He looked at me like I was crazy. But that is exactly what it says there, right? So let's find out how that can be true. And let me start by saying this is not joy because of the pain we experience in the trial. I mean, we're not masochists, right? This joy flows out of truth. It's because we know something, James says. We know the trial is producing something that makes the pain worth it, something we need in our spiritual growth that only the trial can produce. So what do trials produce? Let's look at what James says. He tells us trials produce perseverance, and that's the ability to continue doing the right thing regardless of the resistance. This is such a vital characteristic of mature believers. This ability to keep walking with God, to keep living for his glory, to keep doing the right thing when we feel like doing anything else. When our flesh rises up and shouts out, obedience would be foolish, compromise is reasonable at this point. When those around us, friends and family, think we are fools because we choose to obey God, even when there's a cost. But notice what it says, how valuable this is, how much we need this. It says, as we do that, as we persist in doing the right thing, character, or Christ-likeness, spiritual maturity is fashioned into us. It says, let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete. There it is. So perseverance is necessary to grow in Christ-likeness and maturity, and trials are necessary to grow in perseverance. This is the value of trials, and this is how the Christian lives, right? We don't let our emotions control us. We respond to what we know from the scriptures. We respond to truth. So don't miss this. A key to consistent joy begins with the way we think. I can have joy in this painful trial because I know something. I know truth. I know God is going to work this out for my good. This is going to produce something so valuable that it will make the pain worth it. So never, now listen, so never judge a trial by the temporal pain. Look down the road to what it's producing. I love what Joni Erickson Tada said. Talk about somebody who's learned from her pain. She says, God sometimes allows suffering, but he's always in control and he will always have the last word. So when I go through trials, I'm becoming more and more like my Lord, more like what I want to be, a mature, strong Christian. So trials are never wasted pain, are they? They're essential for our Christian growth. That's why our loving Father sends us into the storm, right? Now know this, it wouldn't be loving if he kept us from the storm, if he kept us from the trials and robbed us of their benefit. So we have the storm raging, the boat flooding, the disciples panicking, and the Savior sleeping. That brings us to our second point, lessons from the sleeping Savior. Look at Mark 4:38. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. So here we get insight into the incarnation, Jesus being both God and man. In a moment, he will display his divinity, calming the storm with a word, but now we become aware of his humanity. He is absolutely exhausted, isn't he? He's sound asleep in the midst of something that should make sleeping impossible, this violent storm. And this shows his body was subject to tiredness just like ours. And we also get a great illustration, though, of the peace available to the Christian. Jesus is always the example of what the Christian can be like, right? He's the prototype Christian. He shows us what we can experience. And in the middle of these frightening circumstances, he is experiencing this deep peace. But how? Well, here is another thought we must add to what we just saw. To have joy, we saw we must view our trials not through the temporal pain they bring, but through the long-term benefits they produce. The pain will be worth it. Now add this to have peace in time of trouble, we must follow Jesus' example. What was that example? Well, he was living closely to the Father and was depending on him, trusting him completely. So how did this intimacy with God and trust work itself out? Well, he knew God loved him and was in total control of all things, including his life in this storm. And this resulted in a deep peace. Psalm 46, 1-3 says this, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. Psalm 62:6, truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. So we have joy in times of trial when we know that they are producing something so valuable. And we have peace in times of trial when we know God is with us, when we live near to him and trust his promises. And right here we see the peace, correct thinking, and the presence of the Father produced in Jesus. You see the same thing with King David when he was surrounded by enemies. Look at Psalm 3, verse 5. I lie down and sleep, I wake again because the Lord sustains me. He says, I will not lie awake all night worried. I know God is in control, therefore I'll be able to sleep. So stay close to God, and when trials hit your life, don't just react. Stop and think. God's in control of all this. He has sent this not to destroy me, but to develop me. It will work out for my good and produce something so valuable that the pain's going to be worth it. Trust God. See, you don't have to be defeated by every adversity, do you? God has given you truth that is powerful enough to bring joy and peace even in times of trouble. But you must read the Bible. You must know that truth. You must understand it and apply it. So Jesus is asleep. Let's look at the disciples' reaction. It's a bit different than his. The disciples' reaction to a sleeping Savior. They get upset and rebuke him. Mark 4:38 says this, but he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him and said to him, Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Now, does that sound familiar at all? Well, it's the same kind of reaction many of us have when storms roll into our lives. God, don't you care about me? You must not if you're allowing something like this to happen. See, they were overwhelmed, weren't they? They thought that they were finished, that they were going to perish. And that's the way it is, isn't it? We get into a trial and we think we're never going to make it. This is it. This trial is too much for me and it's going to destroy me. And where is God? Doesn't he care? So let's add another thought to our mini theology on trials. We've seen God is in control of everything that comes into our life, even the trials, to work for our good. And part of that good is to strengthen us and work spiritual maturity into us, Christ-likeness. So the storms he sends, they're for our benefit. But let's add another thought. that will help us when we believe the trials we're in are too great for us to bear, that we're not going to make it this time. See, Scripture tells us God will never give us more than we can handle, right? 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man, and God is faithful. Here it is. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. So please listen to this. Because God is in control, He sets the limits of every trial within the boundaries of what we are able to handle. Now, we may not think we can handle it. We may feel like we're being crushed and we just can't carry on. But in God's wisdom, and you must trust Him here, sometimes against everything that you feel, in His wisdom, He knows the precise amount of pressure it will take to change us. And it will never be too much pressure that will destroy us. So here it is. He knows just how much stretching we can take without breaking. Now, we are building a foundation of biblical thinking to enable us to handle our trials better, right? So regardless of how you feel, this is the way you must think. We must learn to put our emotions in their place with truth. So the storm is raging. The disciples are panicking and accusing Jesus of not caring. They don't realize the storm is sent because He does care, because He wants them to grow. They don't realize every wave is under His control and that boat is being held by a divine hand. So lessons from the storm, lessons from the sleeping Savior, lessons from the disciples' reaction. Now, lessons from the sudden stillness. This is good. I love this. Mark 4:38 through 39. But He was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke Him and said to Him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And He awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. They wake Him and rebuke Him for what they perceive to be a lack of concern. But watch how Jesus responds. He arises and calmly says to the storm, "Peace, be still," and there is immediate calm. The sea is glass. Peace and be still. This is so important. He could have just said peace, and the winds might stop, but you know, maybe that's just a coincidence. Maybe He just got lucky. So He adds, "Be still," and the sea is like glass. This proves there is no coincidence here. After a large storm, the waves will remain stirred up for hours afterwards, but not this time. He treats the storm like it's a rebellious little child. "Be still," and it obeys. Now put yourself into the scene. Imagine what it was like. The wind is whistling, the sails whipping, the waves are crashing, and the boat is creaking and filling while the disciples are yelling. It is loud, noisy, chaotic, and horrifying. Little man seems so helpless against this raging nature. Then Jesus arises, says three words, and there is immediate calm, silence. The sea that was raging 10 seconds ago is now glass. The boat that was being battered isn't even rocking. Oh, their jaws must have dropped. They probably slumped into the seats, wide-eyed, stunned, and confused. They were probably in a state of shock. What just happened? And now they're really afraid. Mark 4:41. And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey Him?" The power of the wind was terrifying, but we've seen the wind before. But we've never seen anybody tell the wind to knock it off, and it obeys. The truth is, His power dwarfed the might of nature. The truth is, nature bows to Him. And they had seen many miracles before, but this one shocked them. I mean, it's one thing to control a demon, but this? Three words and nature bows to Him? And here is another huge benefit of trials, isn't it? God sent them out into that storm to reveal His greatness to them so that they could see it. And how many times will God send trouble into our lives to do the same thing? See, what this says to me is, when I'm in a trial, I want to look for Him. I want to look for His majesty. I want to ask Him to reveal Himself to me in this time of trouble, because that's part of the lesson the trial wants to teach. I love the saying, every adversity is just another opportunity to show you how great He is. Let me say that again. Every adversity is just another opportunity to show you how great He is. And do you think they thought that the storm was valuable in their life? Well, of course they did. It gave them a greater view of God. They saw who He is. They had just been in God's classroom to learn valuable lessons. And as I was thinking through this, I saw four invaluable lessons learned in the discomfort of this storm. So lessons learned in the storm. First, they got a greater glimpse of Jesus' authority. And this lesson of his authority, it's been ongoing, hasn't it? They've watched a progression of it. They've learned about his authority over sickness and disease. When he says you're healed, you're healed. They've learned about his authority over the demonic realm. When he says come out, they come out. They've learned about his authority in the spiritual realm over sin. When he says you're forgiven, you're forgiven. Now through this storm, they learn that he has authority over creation. When he commands a storm to be still, there is silence. See, they learn that this man is God. This man in their boat is God, that he is the creator. And when he speaks, his creation responds. So God will use impossible situations to exalt himself in our thinking. And this is so important and so valuable, isn't it? Second, they learn that nothing is too hard for him. With a couple of words, he has done what is impossible for man. We are terrified by nature, aren't we? I mean, we live here in Texas. They're constantly talking about tornadoes. We just went through it where they're saying, be ready. You know, there's a chance of a tornado today. I mean, the power of nature, it can be violent and brutal and lethal. And we can do nothing to stop it. We're absolutely powerless against it. And Jesus stands up and says, peace, be still, and it bows. Do you see who he is? See, God will often put us into situations that feel beyond us. Why? To drive us to him, so we can learn that nothing is too hard for him. This is what difficult trials teach us. Again, the trial is just an opportunity. It's the stage for him to display his greatness on. Display it to us. And as we see his greatness, the next lesson is developed. Third, they learn to depend upon him. And notice how it worked. The trial drove them to an end of themselves. That's what trials do, right? They had tried to handle the situation and finally came to the realization that they couldn't. When they saw their abilities weren't enough, that the situation was beyond them, that's when they went to Jesus and cried out for help. And at that point, he moved and they saw how great he was. They witnessed his power in contrast to their own. They were humbled, he was exalted, and their faith grew. They were learning that he was sufficient for whatever situation they were in. Fourth, they learned that he can be trusted in our times of storm. Before the storm, they weren't so sure, right? I mean, don't you care that we perish? Now they know he does. That when you go to him, you find a caring, loving, concerned heart. That he can be trusted when the storms crash into our life. See, this and so much more is all part of that good that trials bring into our life. So we've learned through the severe storm, the sleeping Savior, the sudden stillness. We're learning how to think more biblically, to think about the value of trials and the faithfulness and power of the Savior when we're in trials. The disciples were sent into the storm because it developed them. The storm did what only the storm could do. Now, one more thing, learning through the Savior's scrutiny. He rebukes the storm and then turns to these shocked disciples and look at what he asked them. Verse 40, he said to them, why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? In other words, after all you've seen me do, after you've witnessed my care and concern for people, you still panic during the storm and question whether I care about you? And don't miss the connection between fear and lack of faith here. A lack of faith will always result in fear, won't it? See, little faith has a hard time trusting God in times of trouble. It finds it difficult to rest in his care and rely upon his help. Little faith finds it difficult to trust the scriptures, doesn't it? Such as believing trials really are for our good. And if I don't really believe the trial is for my good, if it's just wasted pain, how can I have joy then? So Jesus gently rebukes them so they will see their faith needs to be strengthened. They needed to start acting like people who had seen the things they had been privileged to see. It was time to put into practice what they knew and apply that to their lives. So Jesus says, think. Don't just react. Think about what you've seen and learned. That should affect you more than it is. But what is the application for us then? See, let's not be too hard on them. I think he might ask many of us the same thing. How many of us have walked with him for years? We have a lifetime of his faithfulness behind us. But still, the storms cause panic and we question God's concern for us. Isn't it time we started acting like people who have been recipients of His goodness for so long? Isn't it time to start acting like we really believe this book we carry? Time to start acting like we really believe the promises are true for us? Isn't it time we stop allowing our feelings to bully us? And time to start mastering them with truth? See, our feelings will always lead us to panic when trials hit, if we let them. Now, you may not understand what you're going through right now if you're in a trial, but you do know this. God is good and faithful, and you can trust God in whatever you're going through. See, the truth is, He loves you and will use this for your good, no matter how painful it might seem right now. So do that. Trust Him. Draw near to Him. Live for His glory in it, whatever it is. The storm may be financial, marital, physical, emotional, but if you'll seek Him, if you'll trust Him, eventually, like these disciples on that lake, you'll see His glory. You'll grow. You'll see how God turns it all around for your good. Your emotions may be shouting out panic. The Bible whispers, rest. And if only you could see what God is doing through this, you would have joy. Well, let's conclude this in lessons from a storm. First, believers who are in the middle of God's will, they're going to go through trials. Why? Because they are necessary for our growth. Second, when we are in trials, what are we to do? So that we can have peace like Jesus did, we must draw near to God and we must think biblically rather than emotionally. See, we must think biblically about God who controls the trials. Then we can rest in His power and faithfulness, in His love for us. Then we need to think biblically about the valuable things the trial is doing in our lives. It is making us into who we want to be, right? Strong believers who are becoming more and more like our Lord. This is the path of joy, even in times of trouble. Well, all right, guys, I hope that is helpful. I really pray this helps you as you're going through your troubles, your tough times. And thank you again for being here. Thank you for watching this. Thank you for praying for me. Thank you for your financial support so that we can keep this up. And if you're interested in that, the links for support are in the description area. And please be praying that these videos get out and help others, that we can reach those who are struggling, that we can reach the lost and show them that Jesus is the Savior they need. Well, all right, guys, I love you. God bless you, and I'll see you in the next video.